WHPR-TV is now on demand. Catch us when you want, how you want, where you want, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Watch your favorite TV shows on demand. And be sure to download the WHPR app. We're now on demand at your demand. WHPRTVDetroitOnDemand.com.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 90 and 91, in 91 in Oakland, Wayne County, right, and 90 in Oakland and Livingston County, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. I have a couple of announcements, but I'd like to tell you what a great show I'm going to have this morning. I have Lisa and Dominique, who are here from the Alzheimer's Association, and I also have an icon, Miss Carol Mariso, and I am so excited about her. She'll be in the second segment, and we're going to, before I get into the first segment, I want to talk about a conference that will be here October 13th through 15th, and that's the Women of Color STEM Conference. It's open to everyone. Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math Conference. And we're having a lot of schools there, but we're also having pre-college students, community leaders, professionals, and they're going to have a job fair, which is really an exciting thing, a career fair that's going to be October 15th. I'm very excited about this because they're trying to steer more girls into science and math. I don't know why they didn't do this 100 years ago, but they were trying to get more young ladies into engineering and those like careers. For me, the arts was my career, so I could not go into that. I wasn't that good in math, but there are a lot of young ladies who have been encouraged in math. I think maybe it would have been different with me if I had been encouraged more in math, but I learned or thought at the time that math was my enemy, unfortunately. I could have been designing a shopping mall. But anyway, neither here nor there. So like I said, my next segment I have the wonderful Ms. Carol Mariso. But let me introduce you to Lisa and Dominique from the Alzheimer's Association of Michigan. Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
And I'm excited to have you here because we're always wondering about Alzheimer's. I mean, the older we get, we kind of wonder about it. Mm-hmm. And if I forget what I left in the kitchen, I have a friend who actually was looking for her car keys the other day and said she had company in from out of town and she couldn't find her car keys. She thought she had given it to her sister. She found them in the refrigerator. Mm-hmm. She doesn't know how they got there, but she found them in the refrigerator. Somebody put those keys in there.
Yeah.
But she says, I remember most things. Mm-hmm. So Let's talk a little bit about dementia, which is Alzheimer's is one of its strains or strands, isn't it?
Yeah, so that's a very common question. So dementia basically is an umbrella term.
Speak a little louder.
I'm sorry, is an umbrella term that basically talks about the symptoms that people experience. So, for example, you know, the short-term memory loss, forgetting things from the recent past, getting lost in familiar environments, having trouble multitasking, whatever the symptom is, that's a sign that there's some, that could be a sign, let me rephrase that, that there's some sort of dementia happening. There's a number of different things that can cause dementia symptoms to occur. And Alzheimer's disease is just one type of disease of the brain, the most commonly diagnosed disease of the brain that causes dementia symptoms.
What are some of the other ones, do you know?
So I know you can have, some of the other symptoms might be having trouble completing familiar tasks. That's a symptom that a lot of times people notice.
Now, some of these things, can't they just happen? Mm-hmm. I mean, just here and there.
Oh, yeah.
But I guess if they start happening a lot,
mm-hmm.
that's when you should cause for concern.
Yeah, you know, I think because there is such awareness of Alzheimer's disease and different types of dementia, you know, people will say, you know, I lose my keys all the time. Does that mean I'm getting dementia? And it doesn't
well,
necessarily
Well, I know
mean
20-year-olds who lose their keys all
I've
the time.
I've done it, too. I've done it, too. I've had my keys show up in places. So basically, the things I sort of think about and mention is, how often is it happening, and is it affecting your ability to function daily? Are these changes significant enough to where you're having trouble functioning the way you used to before? And I don't know if there's anything you would add, but that's
right,
how I would probably answer that
to
the best of our ability. Because stress can cause, you know, people to be more confused, more forgetful.
And illness can.
Absolutely.
Illness can, because I've known some people who got real ill, and it's like they forgot a lot of things, mm-hmm. but then it eventually came back as they got better.
Right, right.
You know, we want to jump, oh, no, they have dementia, they mm-hmm. have this, they have that right now.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me this. Well, what kind of doctor would a person seek out if they find themselves forgetting?
Mm-hmm. So we usually encourage people to see neurologists or sometimes geri psychiatrists, whatever the case might be. Neurologists are doctors that specialize in different cognitive disorders in the brain. So they are the ones that we would encourage people to go see. And we tell a lot of people to, you know, your primary care doctor, you can always talk to about, and, you know, they can always make a referral for you if needed. Basically, whoever has that experience and that expertise with diagnosing different types of dementias are the doctors you would want to go to, and neurologists are usually what we encourage.
Okay, I'm going to talk about race. I'd like to talk about gender. Let me go with gender first. We were talking earlier, and I asked you whether women or men, who is the most, who gets dementia mm-hmm. more?
Well, I know based on our last year's facts and figures, we do know that more women are reported to have Alzheimer's disease more so than men. And I don't remember the specific statistic, but
it
was alarming.
But I wonder why that is. I mean, I guess we have so much on our mind. No, I don't think that has anything to do with it, but I just wonder why that is.
Yeah.
And they're doing studies mm-hmm. on this. Now, what about race?
Okay, so actually in terms of race, although there are over 5 million people that have Alzheimer's. And so of that, the majority of, you know, for that population, actually, African Americans have a higher risk. African Americans have a higher risk.
No stuff.
Yes. And so, and that's where I come in, actually, for the association. A part of my role is I am the African American Community Outreach Coordinator. So I am scheduled to actually kind of go out into the community, educate others, to let people know that the services are here for us. A lot of things that also have been identified in some of our facts is that African Americans are diagnosed in the later stages. So they mm-hmm. actually have it, but because people aren't going to get checked and treated, then they kind of, you know, say, oh, it's just old age, or oh, it's this, or oh, it's that. A lot of people kind of put things to the side. And so they're
now,
being diagnosed.
Now, when you say go get treated.
Well, I use that, not necessarily treated, because we know there is no treatment. There's no treatment for the Alzheimer's disease. There's no cure, and there aren't any prevention methods. And so basically, I kind of mean just to go get screened.
Diagnosed. Right, yes, right. You know, they have these commercials on television now that act like they can slow it down.
So there are medications out there. They're not ideal. And like Danielle said, they're not cures or anything of that nature. But what they have sometimes been shown to do is for somebody who might be on the medication that can sort of where the side effects are okay for them and they're able to handle it, sometimes it can keep them at a higher level of functioning for a longer period of time. But as Danielle also mentioned, it doesn't slow the progression. It doesn't cure the disease, but it can sometimes help people function at a higher level.
Oh, sometimes I can imagine the heartbreak of somebody who has their spouse or parent who no longer recognizes things, or they watched them like fading away. And it wasn't until the last couple of years that I realized when they said patients pass away from, they had Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. I said, well, what are they said they forgot how to eat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Alzheimer's disease in the later stages, we know basically, you know, if you think about it, the brain controls everything in our body. And so in the later stages, what happens is the body is starting to sort of shut down. So a lot of times people will die from complications related to the Alzheimer's disease.
And Alzheimer's is also the sixth leading cause of death in the United States.
You have such a nice voice. She has a beautiful voice. It's so soft. Barbara's on the line. We have a call. Good morning, Barbara.
Good morning. I wanted to ask, what comes first, dementia or Alzheimer's, and what is the difference?
Sure. So dementia is basically a classification of symptoms that are happening. So, you know, I guess to answer your question, dementia is usually what people notice first. However, it's not that dementia comes before Alzheimer's, it's that Alzheimer's is a type of disease of the brain that causes dementia symptoms. So a lot of times people will go to the doctors and they'll realize or they'll report that they have these symptoms of dementia, where Alzheimer's disease then is usually diagnosed after that report, because we know that Alzheimer's disease is one type of disease of the brain that causes those symptoms to occur. So it's not so much one happens before the other, it's the fact that Alzheimer's disease is a cause for dementia symptoms to occur, if that makes sense.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. You know, while you were explaining that to her, I started thinking about cancer. Mm-hmm. There are different kinds of cancers.
Yep,
so dementia
absolutely.
Can be that umbrella term, and then we have Alzheimer's and we have other things under it.
Yep.
So that's how I kind of put it together in my head.
That's a great analogy.
I put that together in my head. So ethnic-wise, African Americans or Black people are more prone to it.
Yes.
Gee.
Yes. And again, like I said, African Americans are being diagnosed in their later stages.
Right. So.
And at that point, it makes it harder to,
you
know, for them to receive the care because they're already kind of progressing in the disease. Mm.
Gee. Well, when should they start seeing the doctor?
As soon as possible.
As soon as we talked about the signs, when they start identifying those signs, and that's when you should go to the doctor.
Because just to piggyback really quick off of that, the treatments that we talked about a lot of times only work in the early stages. A lot of times if people go to the doctor in the middle or later stages, those medications only work for so long. So that's another reason to be tested early.
Well, you know, I think about Glenn
Campbell.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Glenn Campbell, he has it. And I remember when he started talking about it. I don't think now he's in front of a camera much, but he started talking about it. And I remember a lot of people thought that President Reagan had it started having it prior to him leaving office.
Right. And I think a lot of times, too, people sometimes will notice symptoms in themselves or other people will notice symptoms, but it is such a scary reality to think about. I think a lot of times people will think, oh, well, you know, it could just be stress or it could be this or it could be that. So I think a lot of times, because there is that fear, people might see those symptoms but make excuses for it, especially in the earlier stages. And that's why it is kind of hard sometimes to know the difference, or if you notice changes, is it normal aging or is it dementia? And that's why we always say, you know, how often does it happen? Is it affecting your ability to function daily? And if you have any concerns, definitely bring it up to the doctor, even if you're not sure.
Well, how is money raised for Alzheimer's?
Absolutely. So, I mean, the Alzheimer's Association is one of the leading nationwide organizations that fundraises for care support and research. We actually, one of our national fundraisers, and one fundraiser that we're actually having October 1st is called The Walk to End Alzheimer's.
Right. Oh, we have another call.
Oh,
can
sure.
we take it?
Absolutely.
Oh, Dee Dee's on the line. Good morning, Dee Dee.
Thank you, Ms. Pearman, for having this conversation and on your show. Question, are there programs that when they first start, you know, so they can get out of the house, especially in the wintertime, to give, like, the caregivers a break, you know, when someone's still functioning, but they need something to do, you know.
Are you talking about, like, a daycare or something?
A daycare, but not when they're just sitting around, but when they have activities to keep their minds kind of
engaged,
sharp.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, absolutely. You know, through the Alzheimer's Association, depending on the stage of their disease, we have programs for people in the early stages. And then we also own and operate two adult day programs, mm-hmm. as Brenda was mentioning, where these are for people that might need more supervision, more monitoring, and they do provide daily activities. But there's also day programs all throughout the community, lots of them, where basically, you know, they are a place where you can drop off the person with Alzheimer's disease or a related dementia. They're in a safe environment. They usually offer a lunch and a snack, and they usually have activity programming throughout the day, so they're not just sitting around and, you know, being stagnant. They are being active and being socialized and being encouraged to socialize with other participants. And if you call one of our services, we have is our 24-hour helpline. So if you ever wanted to call that helpline, we would be happy to give resources in the community that provide those services.
Can you give the number?
Absolutely. That phone number is 1-800-272-3900.
800-272-3900.
That's correct. Yep.
One other quick question. My son did research, and there's like a watch that you can put on to track the person. I think they have like a GPS. Are you familiar with that?
I'm not familiar specifically with the watch, but I do know that there's lots of different technologies coming out for tracking and things of that nature. But unfortunately, I'm not familiar with that specific device. I don't know if you are, Danielle.
No, not. Yeah. Well, your website have the different devices that they recommend?
If you call our helpline, we do have a listing of different tracking devices that aren't through our association per se, but they've been provided to us from our national, what we call our Medical Alert Plus Safe Return Office, which is a service we provide that's not GPS, but it is an identification system for people with dementia. So yes, we would be able to provide those resources, I believe.
Lisa, what is the website?
The website, now these outside resources, like the day programs and stuff, wouldn't be on there, but for things like our services and programs, our website is www.alz.org/GMC, which stands for Greater Michigan Chapter. And then our
Thank
national,
you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. And just to add to that, our national website, if you just take off the /GMC, that's our national website, which also has a lot of information, facts, figures, things of like that.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dee Dee, for the
Bye-bye.
Call. And so you're gonna have a walk.
Yes. So it's Saturday, October 1st, and it's at Comerica Park.
That's next Saturday.
Yes, it is.
Wow,
next
I guess
week,
it is next Saturday.
Do you
I didn't
believe
even think about that?
It seems
wow.
like Labor Day was day
yeah.
before yesterday.
I mean, it's like a few weeks away, but you're correct. It is
yeah.
next Saturday. So basically, it's not too late to sign up. People can create a team of their own. They can sign up as an individual walker. You can sign up now and raise money leading up to the walk, or you can come the day of. For people that are interested, like I said, it is at Comerica Park. It is rain or shine. You, like I said, you can register the day of or you can pre-register.
Oh, Comerica Park, that's, no, that's not inside. That's outside.
The walk is outside. It's,
right.
it's a 2-mile walk, basically. Everybody is welcome. The registration starts at 11 a.m. And then we have an opening ceremony starting at noon, which is pretty cool. You get to hear stories from people that represent the disease in different ways. And then our walk begins at 12:30 p.m.
And there is no registration fee.
Yep, correct.
Wow, that's wonderful.
We do encourage people to raise money, and there is different levels for incentives. So, for example, a minimum donation of $100, you can get a T-shirt. And then there's also a Champions Club, a Grand Champions Club. So depending on how much you raise, there's incentives for you the day of the walk. So lots you can do.
You know, because Alzheimer's or dementia, it's scary because anybody can get it. We have another phone call. This is Jean. Good morning, Jean.
Hi. Good morning. Brenda, I think you were going to lead into the question I have. What would be the soft sign of dementia / Alzheimer's, all of those, because they kind of fall under the same category. But what should people be looking for in themselves or their loved ones or people they're caregiving to maybe give some signs of what's going on with them? I'm getting feedback, so I'm getting a little confused as I'm talking here. But I understand that dementia is a bit different than Alzheimer's, but Alzheimer's can cause dementia. But what should we be looking for as soft signs of that showing with us?
Sure, absolutely. I can answer that question. So just to clarify something you said, just to educate our callers, it's actually opposite of what you said. So actually, Alzheimer's is a type of dementia. So Alzheimer's doesn't cause dementia. And dementia is actually the syndrome that can be caused by many different things. So, for example, people can sometimes show dementia symptoms from dehydration, from a urinary tract infection. And Alzheimer's disease, again, is one type of disease of the brain that causes those symptoms. But whether it's, there's a lot of overlapping symptoms, no matter what kind of dementia you have. So some of the symptoms that a lot of people notice, for example, first is just forgetting things that normally they would remember. So for example, my grandmother had Alzheimer's, actually. And one of the first things we noticed in her was that she was forgetting our birthdays, which was something she never forgot. So that was a sign. It was something significant enough for us to notice that something was a little off. We also have, I've talked to many people who have said they can't communicate like they used to. Their words aren't coming out the way they used to happen. So you might see changes in communication a little bit here and there. We know that nouns are one of the first types of words to be lost. So sometimes people not being able to say, for example, this is a watch, but maybe calling it like a wrist clock or something because they can't come up with that word. I don't know if you'd add.
Again,
how often is it happening and is it significant enough to impact your daily life? That's the key things here. I know I feel like every time I do education, I feel like everyone leaves thinking they have some sort of dementia, and that's not the case. I don't know if there's anything you would add. I know there's others. There's like, we call it the 10 warning signs.
The 10 warning signs?
Yep. And we
where can people get those 10 warning signs? It's like, you know, for cancer, you know?
Yeah.
Perhaps that should be something that would be given out to the public so you could kind of see it. Because I think that all of us have sometimes when we might have what we call senior moments or lapses or, you know, forgetting things. Like you go open the refrigerator and you say, oh, my gosh, what did I come to look in here for?
Right.
Yeah,
and then it comes back. But those kinds of things there. And I don't think those are indicators of Alzheimer's. However, I think, like you said, sometimes people get it mixed up with stress or brain overload and all that kind of stuff. So how are people to determine what's going on between those kind of things, like stress and brain overload, versus the real soft signs or the 10 major signs of Alzheimer's?
Well, she talked about the website. If you go on the website, once again, can we have the website address?
Absolutely. It's www.alz.org. And if you search Know the 10 Signs, we have a great brochure on what those warning signs are. And also, I believe in that brochure, it also talks about what is normal for typical age-related changes and what is more maybe a sign of dementia. Also, we have an education program that we offer to the community called
The
10 Warning Signs.
Really?
And we discuss all the questions that you just asked are discussed in that presentation as well as the basics.
How often is that?
So they, you know, it just kind of depends on how often it's scheduled, who's requesting it. You could call our helpline or also go to our local website and you can see all of our education programs that are being offered.
What is the number again to the local?
So it's our helpline, our 24-hour Harry L. Nelson helpline is 1-800-272-3900. And also on the national website, there are things you can search e-learning. And I believe don't quote me on this, but I do believe that Know the 10 Signs is one of those e-learning courses you can take on your own if you have access to a computer as well. But we do. Oh, it is. Thank you. But we do offer it in the community as a presentation, too.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you for calling. So next week, Saturday, it starts at 11.
Oh, registration's at 11. And the walk starts at 12:30 with a beautiful opening ceremony at noon.
It's right at Comerica Park.
Right at Comerica Park, yeah.
And how could we donate to the association?
Absolutely. So, again, you could go to our local website. And also you can donate online as well. You can call our helpline to make a donation. If you wanted to donate to the walk specifically, that website is actually www.alz.org/walk. And basically you can create a team there. You can join a team. You can donate as an individual.
Yeah, just walker. Like people do the cancer teams and all of that. I think that would be wonderful. Can you tell me any of the strides that have been made in the last 10 years to, because it seems like in the last 10, 15 years, since the baby boomers have been getting up there, there's been a lot of attention,
Absolutely.
You know. Are any things better?
You know, I would say, you know, I think about my grandmother who had dementia. Man, it's been probably 20 years. And what we know now that we didn't know then is amazing. Even though it seems like we have a long way to go, which we do, we've learned a lot in the last 20 years or so. I will say that I don't remember specifically the amount. I wish I did. But this year we received the biggest increase in research funding nationally than we've ever received.
The baby boomers, honey. Yeah. The baby boomers.
Absolutely. So I think that, like you said, more awareness is being brought to it where we're now getting that funding that we've needed so badly to find the cure and find prevention.
I think sometimes when people who are in control or have the power, they start feeling it or seeing it, then they start pushing the budget.
Absolutely.
I really believe that. And this is just so interesting. I have like 5 million more questions, but I just think that we need to contribute. We need to push the research on this because it's not only for our generations to come.
Absolutely.
And with our ethnic group being at risk, but people need to go to doctors too. It's not only black people, it's white people, it's everybody.
Yep.
People need to start going to the doctor. I really believe that. And sometimes we think if we forget something, we say, oh no, senior moment. But if you have too many senior moments in a day, you need to start thinking about checking with a neurologist. Yeah. Isn't that right?
Absolutely. And, you know, one thing I'd add to the research that we were talking about and seeking a doctor as well is that, you know, we can't do this research and do these trials without volunteers. So we actually also have something called Trial Match, which is an online service where a person can create their own profile and be linked to clinical trials in their area that they can choose whether or not they want to participate in. And doctors are a good resource for that as well.
Oh, really?
And a lot of people that are in the early stages or caring for somebody will sometimes choose some of these clinical trials to take part in. So I think that's important to mention too as well, as far
right.
as the doctors too.
Well, and then another thing, they need support for caregivers because can you imagine just being home with a person all day? It's like having a baby at home once they get in the more advanced stages. Wouldn't you recommend them putting someone in a facility if they can?
So I think, you know, let me know if you, I don't want to answer all your questions, but, you know, I think that it's a subjective choice. Mm-hmm. I think that it really depends on the person's situation. For some people, keeping their loved one at home is best. For some people, moving them into a facility is best. One thing I would say is that there's wonderful facilities out there. It's, you know, a lot of people feel guilt for moving someone, and, you know, I would say, you're caring for them, but you're just caring for them in a different way and you're getting more help. What I will say is if you have your loved one at home in the later stages, you will need help. But there are resources to keep the person in the home that we can also help provide people.
And like you said earlier, there are like daycares and all of this where they can get out and be involved in activities, right?
And there's also resources where they bring people into the home to be a companion to the person there. And there is something called non-medical home care where you don't have to have a medical reason, that you can hire someone to come in and just sit with the person, take them out, go for a walk, whatever the case is. So there's resources for that too.
Fabulous. That phone number once more?
1-800-272-3900 in our website.
www.alz.org/GMC.
Thank you, ladies. This is very informative. So, you know, if you're wondering about it, get on the website. Check it out. I'm going to check it out. You know, just so you know, just because my mother, who is almost 97, doesn't have dementia doesn't mean that I can't get it. Mm-hmm. I'd like to talk about heredity and stuff on another time, too. I really would, you know. So stay tuned. Thank you, ladies. And we'll be right back with Carol Marisa.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Carol Mariso, and I seem to be frozen. Say hi, Carol.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, I'm live. Good morning again. I was trying to do Facebook Live. I'm here with someone I've admired for many, many years. She's so full of talent. It is totally unbelievable. Without further ado, Carol Mariso. Good morning, lady.
Good morning. How are you?
Fine. I want to do a little biographical stuff with you first. So you're from Detroit, right?
Absolutely.
You were born here?
Yes.
And then, we all know you went to CAS.
Right.
And then you ended up teaching at CAS.
Right.
A lot of people who go to CAS who become teachers love to go back and teach at CAS.
It's a wonderful experience, and it's a great opportunity to give back to students who have so much to develop, and they're so talented, all of them. It's just a great school. Still.
So when you were coming up, you started taking dance lessons also, or what?
Oh, my mother was, my mother was determined to make my sister and myself be exposed to as many different art forms as we possibly could.
I want to say hi to your sister.
she loved dance, so she put us in it. She thought that was a great way for a young lady.
Who did you study with?
Oh, I started my studies with LeClaire Knox way over, I think, on the east side when I was about 3 or 4. And then when we moved to the west side, I continued my studies at Ziggy Johnson School of
Ziggy
Theater.
Ziggy Johnson.
I ended up teaching there also for many years. I also studied ballet with Norma and Robert Tainton. And then as I decided I was going to become a professional dancer, I continued my studies with Clifford Fears and Catherine Dunham.
So you studied with Catherine Dunham?
I most certainly did in East St. Louis. Studied Dunham technique.
Oh, wow.
And then I studied...
What made her technique? What was the difference between her technique and other people? Why people always think of the Dunham technique?
Because up until that point, Afro-folkloric dance is what we called it. And it was, you know, folkloric, but it didn't have any way to train to be able to do those kinds of movements.
Okay.
All other dance forms, professional dance forms, had different ways of training the body to be able to do those particular styles of dance more efficiently. And so she was the first person to develop a technique that enhanced the human body and trained the human body to be able to execute African movements, the whole African diaspora of movement, in a more efficient and, shall we say, a more homogeneous manner.
Okay, so you ended up touring? Did you tour?
Oh, yeah, with my own company, yes.
Right. And you started your own company when?
Right. The company was started in 1970, and we toured. We went to, we toured New York. We're the only professional company, I think maybe in Michigan, to have a premiere at Lincoln Center.
Oh.
So we did that tour. We did the Southeast. We did a university tour. We went to Hampton. We went to Bowling Green. We toured Haiti, and I personally went to France on behalf of the company.
Yes.
And to Africa. Yeah. Did I say Africa?
No.
Yeah, in Africa. We went to we were participants in FESTAC 77, which was in Nigeria.
Wow! Amazing!
That
amazing!
Was an amazing!
It had to was
experience
in
to see.
Lagos. Was
yes.
it in Lagos?
Yes.
Oh wow! Amazing! Oh, I just wanted to remind everybody that right after this show, we're doing Table Talk, and you know there was a lot of news this week, so we got a lot to talk about. Now, did you? So you performed in Lagos.
Right.
Wow, that's amazing. They appreciated it, didn't they?
Oh, they loved it. We were superstars in Lagos. It was wonderful. They really appreciated the American, African-American dances that we did. A lot of the companies that went at the same time performed African dance. And the Nigerian people, it was more than Nigerian people, it was the African peoples really from all over the world. They enjoyed seeing how the African dance had really traveled to all of these different places
into
America and everything. But they appreciated what we did even more, because they wanted to see what is it that African Americans had developed. What have we done with this African
style?
We did jazz, and we did tap for them, and they just loved all of that. They loved seeing what African Americans were doing, not just African style, but how it had evolved into those styles, those new styles.
Fantastic, fantastic. And so you taught many people, you had your company, everybody heard about your company or went to see your company. But let's kind of go back to the art. What mediums do you work with?
Well, my favorite medium is oil painting. But I do oil, acrylic. I'm terrible at watercolor, but I still do it. And I like sculpture also. So.
I took a class. I tried to learn pastels.
Mm-hmm.
But the unfortunate thing is I went to a class in Birmingham, and everybody in the class had something before. I was just a beginner.
Mm-hmm.
And the teacher took it for granted everyone knew how, and I told her, I don't know. I just bought these supplies. I want to learn, and I was always looking for. I need a place to learn, because I won an art contest in grade school, and I always wanted to get back to art. And so you do. So you don't do pastel.
I do chalk pastel. Yes, it's not my favorite medium, but chalk pastel I think is really a difficult medium, and it's too bad that is cheap. So therefore, the public school systems use chalk pastels a lot, but it's a very difficult medium to really master. But it's fun,
Well,
and in support of what you were doing with your class, sometimes you can learn more from your fellow students than you can from your teacher.
I certainly did.
And you had to watch, how people do things.
Yeah, because she wasn't teaching. She was just patronizing everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And so When did you start drawing?
I have drawn and done art all my life. Well, and back to my mother. She wanted us to have dance to groom us.
She was cultured, wasn't she?
She was. She was a very cultured lady. And she was an artist. She had wanted to become a professional artist, but in those days, in the 1920s, you know, it wasn't that prevalent, and you didn't get that much support. So she didn't. She put her art career on hold and ended up raising a family and everything. But she always did creative things in the household and art in the household. And so I was raised in a household that was always filled with art. We painted murals and things in our basements. And
you did?
Oh yeah.
Oh, that was wonderful. And it's so great to be in a household where the arts are encouraged. Mm-hmm. You know, with Black people, a lot of times they say, oh, yeah, that's nice, but you need something substantial to fall back on. You need a job. I remember when I told my mother I was going to major and change my major to drama, she said, oh, you'll starve. Mm-hmm. I said, well, I'll teach it. Mm-hmm. You know, that was the way to calm her down. Mm-hmm. And it's just,
I think for many of us that.
Yeah, but I just, there was never a lot of support for that outside thing that I did. Mm-hmm. But it's so fortunate that you had a mom that encourage that.
Oh, yeah.
Encourage that. And your book, this is just a wonderful book. It's Paintings and Drawings by Carol Mariso. And we're going to show you some of them. And just a moment, we're going to put some of your art on screen. Okay. And you could tell us what the motivation was, how you came about it. Oh, right there, a little Cool.
Oh, yeah. This is one of my favorite pieces, and I know that you will understand the motivation behind this. This is my granddaughter, and one day, she lives in California. I was out visiting, and we were just playing around in the house and everything, and so she got these glasses, and she put them on, and just the way she just cocked her head and just kind of just said, well, you know, it just spoke to me that she thinks she's a little cool. I think I like
that. Wow, that was beautiful. Then we go to the next one.
And that's oil.
Oh, and that's oil.
Oil, yeah.
Okay.
I think probably most of the painting, all the paintings you'll see are oil.
Okay, right here. Would you pronounce that?
Après le bain, which means after bathing in French.
Uh-huh.
And I particularly like this piece. The model is a wonderful model. She has a beautiful back, and it's just a joy to paint this particular model. And I really was developing how to render skin tones.
Oh,
okay. And so I really thought that I did an adequate job on
that. I think you did a great, because my mother says, you know, we have different colors, you know, we have different colors on us, you mm-hmm. know, different parts of us can be different colors. Mm-hmm. And it seems like you picked that up. Uh-oh, what we have. Oh, that's you.
That's me. And that's what I call a psychological portrait.
As soon as they get that yes. Well, because your conversation with brushes.
Right. And it's just to express the dilemma that I think artists go through either all the time or at least some of the time, and most artists have that experience where you know, you just want to know, well, let's see, what brush will I use? Which one is going to give me the exact curve, the exact line that I need to get into this really, really tight space, or maybe this really, really nice broad space that you're covering.
Now,
I work not only representatively, or some people say not realistically, but representational, but I also paint and create abstract pieces also. This piece was created and during one summer when I was very interested in looking at hummingbirds. I have a deck and a hummingbird feeder next to it, and I just love seeing those little tiny little creatures. The way the movements of their wings are just so incredibly fast, and the way that they do that, and then they hover so that they look like they're not moving at all. So I was trying to capture that staccato movement.
Oh, okay.
In fact, those pieces started off as 20 different pieces.
Really?
Yeah, 20 a series of 20, and it just didn't do what I wanted it to do in terms of the staccato movement, and so I ended up, you know, cutting them and rearranging them so that they created a more.
Oh, okay. In plain view, this mm-hmm. one just mesmerized me.
This is a gentleman who is like enslaved, and he's like on the cusp. He's an older man, you know, and he doesn't know whether he really wants to escape. The opportunity for him to escape has come, but he doesn't know if he really wants to do that because he knows that his presence will slow down everyone else, and he may endanger everyone, you know, the entire
wow.
group that wants to go. So,
what's the motivation for that?
The motivation was really the background, which was a family quilt, which was an Underground Railroad quilt. And I was thinking about
wow.
all the things, the emotions that must have gone forth with that quilt.
Wow, the next one that just came up on the screen briefly was Jijora?
Jijora. Yes, that's a Yoruban term, and it means art is anything, or is all things from abstraction to naturalism. And so I was creating a piece that was natural, but also was expressed abstraction also.
Wow.
And that's chalk, that's oil pastel.
Oh, it is.
Yeah. Oil. In fact, it's oil pastel, chalk pastel, and acrylic. It's a mixed media.
Oh, it's mixed media. Mm-hmm. Okay. We have another one that should be coming up in just a second, which is Legacy, which I really want to know about as soon as... yes.
Mm-hmm.
The colors. Yeah, look at that. What is it, a shawl or...
That is kente cloth.
I know it's kente
yeah.
cloth.
So it's the kente cloth represents ancestry.
Right.
And I wanted it to float through almost like clouds into the sky, into the heavens. So that's why it's draped in that manner. It's kind of like a almost a surrealistic kind of a piece, where you have the older man passing on the legacy to the African child. Uh-huh. And the energy is expressed through that hand. And there's an area in the middle of the canvas that expresses civil disobedience and the things that we African Americans as a people, we pass on that legacy, not only the great historical richness of our culture, but we also pass on the hurt and the civil disobedience and that must be dealt with in order to diminish that.
It seems like it's very, very current, huh?
Yes.
It's very topical. Oh, I love this. Old swimming hole.
Old swimming hole, right. To our generation and past generations, I think an old swimming hole was like somewhere in the country. My daddy
right,
used to talk
right,
about
right.
the old swimming hole. So I wanted to express what the old swimming hole was will probably be to these newer generations
yeah.
that grow up in plastic pools.
Yes, 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 yes. We used to, we'd make it way out of nowhere when
mm-hmm.
we were playing.
And go
to
the lake.
Right,
you know,
right, right. And just, I mean, we'd do things with sticks
right,
even. I
right.
mean, and oh, this next one that we're going to see, Prince. Isn't this is something. Tell us about this.
This is my most recent one, and it's the idiom in which I'm working now, where I'm going way off into color. I'm just having a ball doing it, and it's got four quadrants, as you see. Then in each quadrant, I'm attacking or working with, I should say, the color theory. So I've got an area that is complementary, which is the blue and the orange. I've got an area that is naturalistic colors. I've got an area that is monochromatic.
Yeah.
And an area that shows neutrals. And so I'm doing a series like that. I've got, right now I've only completed two. I'm working on a third. I did Prince and I did Whitney Houston. I'm trying to do like these social icons and artistic icons.
Who died too soon?
No, who died too soon, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Now this next one, Robert 1200?
Yes. This is also a person on the cusp of slavery.
Yeah, cotton,
exactly. He's holding a very precious, precious bundle of cotton that in my mind I'm trying to have him express that it's a way out. A way for him to be determined. I hope that I show the determination in his eyes to be a success and be able to maybe possibly reap this harvest of this cotton so that he can own his own farm. And I had relatives that did that, you know.
Wait, girl, cotton. Speaking of cotton, I was born in a little town called King Street, South Carolina. Mm-hmm. I was just born on vacation, so I was there 6 weeks, and you know. But I went back to find the hospital I was born in. Uh-huh. And walked clear into a cotton field. It was like a house in the middle of a cotton field. It was just the weirdest thing.
That was the
thing.
Hospital?
That was the Benevolence Hospital. I guess it's for the black people, uh-huh. You know. Yeah. It was just a big house.
Wow.
And cotton and tobacco. Mm-hmm. Tobacco was the other thing that they did down there, mm-hmm. and then picking it and grading it. Mm-hmm. And I just, it's hard work. This is hard work.
Very hard work. Very hard work. People think, oh, picking cotton, that's easy. You just
The
cotton bowl itself has those thong things on it, and when you reach out down in there, you get scratches and prickles and stuff. It's really difficult.
Right, we couldn't do it.
I don't think we could.
And you're on display down at the Scarab Club, right?
Not presently. I just finished a
you just
one
finished
woman
it.
Show.
Right, yeah, there, right, right. So what's next?
Well, I'm working on my new series, and I'm hoping that, with the book that I published, that's like one section of my
this
creative soul.
This book is so phenomenal. Everyone, this book is so phenomenal. I mean, your faces and what I told her, and I think that you saw it when you looked at some of her art, was the emotion that was involved in her art. Even the one of the nude had emotion in it. Mm-hmm. Why do you think that?
I aim for because I feel that when I paint a person's face, it's to me they're not portraits. To me, they are iconic figures of a particular that represent a particular group or a particular mood, and those are the people that I want to paint. Like even the young woman who you saw from the back, her back reads as a very strong individual.
And not a youthful
individual. Right.
Which I was really relating to that. I said, God, I could have posed. Oh, but you would have had a little more to do. I just think, how can we get this book?
That book is available at the Scarab Club. Or you can
tell everyone the address of the Scarab Club.
217 Farnsworth. It's right behind the Detroit Institute of Arts.
Right.
And of course, you can get it from me, Carol Mauriceau. I'm available at mauriceau@att.net. That's my email.
And your website is
www.mauriceauart.com.
Now, tell people how to spell Mauriceau.
I sure will. Mauriceau.
I always thought that was just such a beautiful name.
Oh, thank you.
What is the root of that name?
It's a French name. The family is from Haiti. Yeah, so it's a Haitian name.
Just amazing. You are so... You're like a superstar in so many arenas. No, seriously. I mean, I would watch her from afar, and then I'd be hearing about, I studied with Carol Marie. So that was like the brag, the brag. And I am just so pleased that one of my contemporaries is here. Oh, man. This one with the guy with the UAW jacket on. Mm-hmm. That is interesting. The wait. He's in an unemployment office. This art is phenomenal, and it makes you feel what he's feeling. He's wondering what.
He's wondering when and if he's going to get a job. It was that whole series was done during our financial crisis of between 2006 and 2010, and the series has three pieces. And in the series, I wanted to show that. Everyone suffered during that era, whether you, it didn't matter what ethnic group you were in, didn't matter your age. So everyone was on the unemployment line.
I wanted
to express that. Yeah.
You know, Carol, when you finish your next series, would you come back?
Oh, I'd love to. I am so excited about that.
We have to talk and everything. I'm just so excited about you, and I just want to regale you because, you know, we are women of a certain age. And
I like that.
Yes, and I just think that, you know, people have to believe life isn't over.
Right.
I mean, in many ways, it's just beginning.
Right. I think in my artwork in particular, I think I have so much more energy and so much more imagination. And I'm not afraid to do anything.
I know.
You know, just at this point, I'm like, I don't care. I'm going to do this.
And you're not afraid what people say.
Right.
So listen, everybody, Table Talk is next. Carol Mariso, thank you so much for coming on my show.
It was a pleasure. Thank you.
Oh, wow. We're going to talk after this.
Okay.
And ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned. I have Ken Coleman and Ellis Liddell, who are my co-hosts this morning.